sometimes happens with the type of business
called Cipher. And she'll figure it out. Ready? Come on up. So will you please stand, and on this Easter morning, join me in this greeting. Rejoice, heavenly choirs of angels.
Rejoice, all creation around us.
Jesus Christ, our King, is risen.
Sound the trumpet of salvation.
Rejoice, O earth, in shining splendor.
Radiant in the brightness of your King.
Christ has conquered. Glory fills you.
Darkness vanishes forever.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Glory and honor, dominion and power be to God forever and ever. Christ is risen. Hallelujah. Number 302.
Thank you.
initiated your only and begotten Son to the death of the cross, and by his glorious resurrection delivered us from the power of our enemy, grant us so to die daily to sin, that we may evermore live with him in the joy of his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated, please. Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and good morning. There is a traditional greeting. We'll test you and see how many of you know it if you were at the first service this morning at the beautiful, amazing sunrise service on the lake. You'll know the answers, and you can lead the rest of us. If I say to you as a Christian on Easter morning, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
And the third time, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Amen. Hallelujah. Well, we're going to move right along. Easter is one of those special times where we get to see a lot of people. And we wanted to celebrate the life of the church that has happened since last Easter. And one of the ways to do that is on a new screen, which you're going to, well, you might have noticed it. So I'm going to invite Sherry to bring the kids up. That's going to be the content of their children's time. And choir, if you want to, you can swing around so you can watch it if you like. Otherwise, we'll have a private show later. But you're welcome. You can be children. Yeah, come on down. These are pretty good. If you don't want to, it's okay.
So we can watch this.
Now, I've been cautioned to forewarn you that you're going to be seeing a lot of life at a quick pace. So that if you get frustrated about not being able to pick out a particular kid in a large scene, we'll show it again probably many times and slow it down. But in order to pack a year into 8 minutes, you'll get to see the life of your church. You know, what is the church? It's not the building. It's you, the people. It's the kids and the grandparents and the teenagers and the youth. And it's all the things that happen in the spirit of Christ around the world. And around this community. So, without further ado, Sherry, we're going to go ahead and review the year.
Amen. Sarah, you want to say something about summing up the year?
To see all of you kids, so many of you having participated in so many of those things, and I just want to thank you from the bottom of my heart to all of you who have put in time and effort to help the Lord, to serve the Lord, and to help our church out in all the different ways. I just think it was such a wonderful way to wrap up the year, and anyway, why don't we close this section with prayer, and any of you that are going to Children's Church with me can follow me through that door, okay? All right, let's close our eyes and bow our heads. Dear Father God, thank you so much for this wonderful day. Thank you for this morning. We have come together to worship you, to thank you for loving us so much, and for the promise of resurrection, for the promise of being with you again in heaven forever. And that's a wonderful reason to celebrate. We thank you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
Soldiers,
thieves,
cross peace. Nails.
Pound. Okay, for those of you that are guests here, we have a little tradition we call Joys and Concerns. If you have a joy that you'd like to share with us, raise your hand and I'll get the mic back to you if you've got a concern that you would like us to pray for the same. So we'll get started. I have a concern. I'd like for you to keep some folks in your prayers. The Erie School District had a bad car accident last week. The lady that's the principal at Erie Elementary School and a para and the principal's son were going to Pittsburgh for a Special Olympics, and they were involved in a bad car accident. So they're doing okay, but they need your prayers. So keep the Simrods and our Rich Wine families in your prayers. Anybody else? Dodie Nolan, keep her in our prayers.
Forrest Matlock.
Forrest Matlock. Anyone else?
Gary Manbeck.
Anyone else? Joy Christian. Paul?
So, Tuesday night, went up to KC, Shawnee Mission Birth Center, Shawnee Mission Medical Center, waiting with my mother for my brother Grant and his wife Kristen to have their first baby. It was about 10 o'clock, and Mom said, "Why don't you just go home? She's had a three. It's going to take hours." I said, "All right, if I get home, you call me, and this sucker's coming out. I'm going to be mad." I get home at 12:30, and I get a call. So at 12:30, Gideon Charles Myers was born into this world at 5 pounds, 8 ounces, 18 and a half inches.
Being an uncle is fun. Being an uncle is fun.
Uncle for the third time.
Anyone else have a joy? Anybody else?
Yes, we have the joy of seeing our three grandchildren who want to be baptized today, Cody, Jared Benton, and Jaron Hockett, and their mom, Michelle.
You bet. Well,
it's also a joy that there's a number of youngsters that are going to be confirmed today in our faith. This is a very big day for them as well, for the whole class. That's a great joy.
I accompanied my dad this week on the honor flight to Washington, D.C. There were 25 World War II veterans that went. It was a wonderful, wonderful experience. If any of you or your fathers or grandfathers have not gone, the Kansas Honor Flight's a wonderful thing, and I'd like for you to keep my mom in your prayers. Thank you.
Okay, Hal, did you want to come up and say a word at this time? He's going to borrow the mic from you. Since Terry raised the screen.
Hal Jones.
Hal asked for a chance to visit with the congregation.
Chairman of the Trustees, so Hal.
He's in a tie. That's pretty amazing to me. I haven't seen Hal. I haven't seen Hal in the tie very much.
Hello. What a wonderful addition to our service. It's just a great thing. Kind of wanted to share a little story with you. First of all, I want to thank the trustees of the church for having the insight to vote, I guess, to install this screen. We've had a few hurdles. I want a special thanks to Rick Willis for helping install it, Tim Hatch, Jim Schoenberger, myself, Pastor Paul, Dr. Wynn helped us out a little too.
Perry, Perry, man.
Perry Ann fed us. Rhonda took pictures, lots of pictures. We had some hurdles. If you were here last Sunday, this was not there. I think it was, somewhere around the first week of April, I got an email from the gentleman that was going to be an installer. And when their installer is, it's, you have it all ready for us, we come and hang the screens and show you how to operate. So the church members did most of the work. But I announced in second service to Pastor Paul that I got an email and that he would be here on the 17th. We were shooting to get this installed by Easter. His first comment was, if we're going to pull this off, it's going to be a miracle. Well, we're looking at a miracle.
Amen.
Just a little more on it. I received an email about a week ago Monday, from the installer, and he said the equipment will be there Wednesday or Thursday. And I said, of this week? He said, no. I said, you're going to be here before the screen? Possibly. And yes, that's the way it happened. He even canceled his flight, moved it back a day. We received this about 3:30 Thursday afternoon. So we were all pacing the floor. It showed up. We got everything unpacked. Couldn't find the main power cable. Uh-oh. So we did find it after looking through some boxes we thought were empty. And everybody pulled together. We got it done. And we did create a miracle. That's all I had.
Well, I would give credit to the Lord. He had a few helpers along the way. We are obviously, having just barely gotten it installed, there will be further use of the screen, and it will do more for the worship services than we're doing with it this morning. But we thought, what a beautiful way to introduce this worship screen than by celebrating the life of the church with the kids and the adults and the grandmas and the grandpas and the saints in every age and condition being reflected back to the gathered Easter community. We thought that was pretty special. And, you know, you're really the ones that made that happen. You're the ones that made what we showed you happen. And I think Hal would feel we were a little remiss if we didn't say we could use a little help paying for it. But it is going to be worthy of the organ, worthy of the sanctuary, worthy of the worship that we intend it to augment. So thank you kindly for all of your loving care. And thanks, Hal.
Hey, thank you, trustees. And Hal.
Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you. Anyone else have any joys or concerns?
That's a miracle, but it doesn't begin to match the miracle of the empty cross. Praise Jesus. Thank you.
That's why the cross is there and the screen is over there. The cross is still the focal point. You're exactly right, Robert. And that was one of the wrestling matches we had. This is still the focal point. A 12-foot cross is the center of the heart of our worship and our congregation. It is.
Anyone else? Okay.
Okay, let's enter into a spirit of prayer. We lift your name on high. We give thanks to you. We rejoice in our spirits and our souls. And when we understand what happened on Easter morning, we have no words that can express the change, the gift, the new creation that you have accomplished in Jesus our Savior, and the love that you have borne the world. Gracious God, we give you thanks and praise for this Easter Sunday and your gathered people all around the world in every time zone, in every color, in every shape, in every size, in every time, this morning are saying, Christ is risen, he is risen indeed. Gracious God, we thank you for Gideon Charles Myers. We thank you for the joy of the baptisms and the confirmations that will take place this morning. We thank you for an honor flight of World War II vets and their families. We lift up to you and we ask for your presence, your power, your healing strength to be in the Erie principal and her son and the para that were so seriously injured in the car wreck. We lift up to you, Dodie Nolan, that you would continue the journey with her during this time of cancer. We lift up to you, Horace Matlock, and we lift up to you, Gary Manbeck. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And now hear the prayers of your people.
Very good.
Lord, in your mercy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. 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 People of Syria, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. The people in the Honduras mission, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. For the people of Crimea, Russia, Ukraine, the NATO, for wisdom and talking to take place instead of anything conflicted, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Now with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Is Lisa here? Okay, Lisa Armstrong had to work this morning, or she would have been here to talk to you about where the offering is going to go this morning. The offering is going to go to people who live in a hillside country in poverty in Honduras. It's the mission that you're familiar with. It's the mission that many of you have visited. It's the mission that God laid on Lisa Armstrong's heart to found, establish, and continue to direct. The money that you give today to resource that mission is going to go to the work of Christ in a place where it is deeply needed. So on her behalf, without being able to tell you the particular stories, I would ask you to share out the bounty that God has given you and blessed you and your family with, and share according to how God inspires you to share this morning in this Easter offering out of gratitude, which will alleviate the suffering of many, which will provide medical care, shelter, housing, and sometimes needed equipment, certainly needed medicine for people in this remote place, in this very, very poor country. So without anything more, let us worship God with our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings. Thank you.
O Lord, from thee. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated, please.
Did you get nervous when I left the sanctuary?
Probably didn't notice.
All right, this is a very special time in the life of this church. Would you turn to page 33, and I will ask the families of the families getting baptized, the individuals getting baptized, and the confirmants to come up. It's going to be just a little different than we rehearsed it. But the confirmants and their families, if you'll come on up and get at the altar. Remember the position, the last position you were at the altar. So come on up and stand behind your confirmants. Because as I give these vows, I'll give them to all of you at once, including the ones being baptized. And you'll remember the vows, and then we'll, you know the drill at the end. We have rehearsed this. So yeah, you could be on this side. And then Amy and her family on this side, and the others take up your places at the altar, and you'll face me when I give the vows, and the congregation will listen in. This is such a historic thing that we're doing this morning. Yeah, we're going to have a crowd up here. But in the early church, yeah, come on up. You can support your kids. We'll fit. We've got a lot of room. In fact, we've also figured out that the sanctuary will hold as many people as we put up. First, one of the things I want to say is thank you to Linda Robbins for the work that she has done with the confirmation class. She is faithful and perseverant and tough. She really puts them through their paces. How many of you went through a confirmation class with Linda Robbins? I see hands. Yeah. Well, I would like you to thank God for the ministry of Linda Robbins right now and in any way you might care to do so. Thank you, Linda. Let's see. Where's Amy? Okay. Amy, and if I get you and your mom and your family over on this side. All right. Now, this is, as I was reflecting on it, I figured that you all are going to be able to repeat your vows. You confirmands, you repeat your vows at the same time that I'm giving these vows to this family. Put you right here, okay? Michelle and Aaron and Jacoby and Jerrica and Jaron. This is such an exciting day. We're going to have a baptism of a whole family. And that whole family is going to start out with Aaron, who is going to reaffirm his baptism, and then we'll proceed right chronologically. But before we do anything else, this little bottle is filled with water from the River Jordan, and it's going to be added to the waters of Chanute and the various rivers that we probably get our water from. I'm going to ask Amy to pour the first half of that in, since she's being baptized as one of our confirmants today. And I'm going to ask Jacoby to do the second half. Jacoby, there is still a drop in there. If you can shake that drop out. Shake that drop out. Yeah, good. You got it. All right. That's kind of special. It was Glenn Brown and Gwen Pitts, who went to the Holy Land in 2003 and brought back 2 liters of water from the River Jordan in a place that they think was quite near to where Jesus was baptized. And this is the last of that 2-liter bottle. This is it. So God had it timed out perfectly, just perfectly, and I'm thrilled to be involved with you. So now you get it that you're all the confirmants are going to respond to the answers that our baptizees are going to respond to and our reaffirming is going to respond to. Each time I give you a prompt, or I will or an I do, I want you to think about what you're saying because it's your time as an adult in the life of the church. I'll tell you what, I can do this out here so that everybody can see you as you respond, okay? Brothers and sisters, in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price. Moving to number 34 and beginning with the The vows that you have practiced and researched and heard about as parents and confirmands, and the vows that we have rehearsed and practiced in the sanctuary before we did this. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, your answer is, I do.
I do.
I want to hear it just a little louder. Your answer is, I do.
I do.
Thank you. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, your answer is, I do.
I do.
Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to all, to people of all ages and nations and races? If so, your answer is, I do. Okay, now, to Mom and Dad on behalf of Jaron, okay? To Mom and Dad on behalf of Jaron, and to Big Brothers and Sister, okay? So this is going to you and Chakotay and to Grandmas and Grandpas. Will you nurture Jaron in Christ's Holy Church that by your teaching and example, she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? If so, your answer is, I will. Okay, thank you. Now, according to the grace given to you, all confirmants, listen up. According to the grace given to you, will you remain faithful members of Christ's Holy Church and serve as Christ's representative in the world? If so, your answer is, I will. Okay. Do you, as Christ's body, are you following along? Number 8 on page 35, this is your part. I want to hear it nice and loud. Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include these amazing persons before you? Wave your hands, confirmants. Put your hands up. Wave your hands, confirmants. Go ahead, Isabella. I can't see your hand. There you go. All right. All of you. Yes, yes. And this family here that's coming in. Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include these amazing persons now before you in your care? And now I want to hear it with conviction. And live according to the example of Christ. We will surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness that they may grow in their trust of God and be found faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life. Let us join together in professing the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments. We will not do the full form, but we will do the main core. Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ? I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit. Do you? Okay, that's it. You've got the three. The triune God is what we call God because we understand one God in three persons. One God in three persons. And you've studied that with your confirmation teacher. Now let's give thanks over the water. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Eternal God, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell of God's mercy each day. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations. Declare his works to the nations, his glory among all the people. Pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and those who receive it, to wash away their sin and clothe them in righteousness throughout their lives, that dying and being raised with Christ, they may share in His final victory. All praise to you, Eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen. Okay, Aaron, you're going to be reaffirming. I'm going to ask you to come over. Go ahead and put your hand in the water and remember your baptism and be thankful. I'll ask you to kneel down. And family, we're going to lay hands on Dad, husband, and we're going to pray. Aaron, the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. And the people said, Amen. Okay. Michelle. Tell you what, Jared. Well, no, Jared, you don't need to hold it. I'll ask Grandpa to hold it. Just hold that book for me, will you, Grandpa? All righty. Michelle, you can go ahead and kneel down. And your middle name. Okay. Michelle Renee, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, even Jesus Christ our Lord. Okay, family, lay your hands on her, including Grandma and Grandpa. Come ahead. Lay hands on her by extension or directly. Michelle, the Holy Spirit work within you that you may become a true disciple of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And the people said, Amen. Okay, Jacody. Here's the card. Good. With the middle name. It's my cheat sheet. Okay, I'll just go with the first name then, okay? Unless you want your middle name, what's your middle name? All right, we're going to do it. We're going to do it. Jacody, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, even Jesus Christ our Lord. Now let's lay hands on, family. Let's lay hands on. Oh, Jerem's loving this. Yeah. Jacody, Holy Spirit work within you that being born by water and the Spirit, you may become a true disciple of Jesus Christ. And the people said, Amen. Okay. Jericho, it's your turn. Middle name? Okay. Would you go ahead and kneel for me? Jericho? Jericho Marie, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, even Jesus Christ our Lord. Okay, family, lay hands on. Jericho, the Holy Spirit work within you that you may become a true and faithful disciple of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, being born by water and the Spirit. And the people said, Amen. Okay, Jaron, what's your middle name? Jaron Dawn. Okay, would you kneel down for me? Jaron Dawn, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, even Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now, will the people will come out and lay hands on Jared. Jared Dawn, the Holy, being born of water and the Spirit, may the Holy Spirit work within you that you will become a true disciple of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And the people said, Amen. Amen. Okay, Amy. Good. All right. All right. I'll ask you to kneel right here, Amy. And Mom, want to get behind her? All right. And we've got Sue Lynn, that's your middle name, correct? Okay. Amy, Sue Lynn, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, even Jesus Christ, our Lord. Lord, we lay hands on. Amy, being born of water and the Spirit, the Holy Spirit work within you that you may become a true disciple of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And the people said, Amen. Okay. Thank you. Now this is part one on page 37, if you're following along. You know this. Now it is our joy to welcome our new sisters and brothers in Christ. Through baptism, you are incorporated by the Holy Spirit into God's new creation and made to share in Christ's royal priesthood. We are all one in Christ Jesus. With joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you as members of the family of Christ.
Now I can hear a response from the congregation. How about a giant amen? One, two, three.
Amen.
I like that. All right, now we're going to move to the confirmation portion. Remember where you took your stations as we rehearsed a couple weeks ago. Stand behind your confirmand and we'll begin one at a time. The confirmands and their families will be coming up to the altar to receive. And you remember what you do with the baptismal font, right, confirmands? And I've got Sharon Fritsch, our Director of Youth Ministries, and we've got our Director of the Confirmation Class here, Linda Robbins. So, are you first? Okay, now you got to go touch the water. Okay, come on up. Stand behind her. All right, you can kneel down. Go ahead and lay hands on her. Natalie Jean, remember your baptism and be thankful. Natalie, the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born by water and the Spirit, you may become a true disciple of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And the people of God said, Amen. Amen. All right, congratulations. Good to see you. Now give me some hugs. Yes. Good. Congratulations. It's wonderful. Wonderful. Thank you. Thanks. All right. Jacoby, go touch the water again. I know you remember it. This is one of those things where you say, well, I remember it. Yeah, because it just happened. Jacoby G. Gregory, remember your baptism and be thankful. Jacoby, the Holy Spirit work within you that being born by water and the Spirit, you may become a true disciple and faithful disciple of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And the people of God said, Amen. Congratulations. Bless you. Ah, good. Hugs. It's important. All right. Good, Sue Lynn. Amy Sue Lynn, remember your baptism and be thankful. Amy, being born of water and the Spirit, may the Holy Spirit work within you that you may become a true and faithful disciple of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And the people of God said, Amen. Guy's walking and he was in crutches for a while, so we prayed about that healing as a young athlete. Alexander Christian, remember your baptism and be thankful. Alexander, the Holy Spirit work within you that being born by water and the Spirit, you may become a true and faithful disciple of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And the people of God say, Amen. Amen. Congratulations. Thank you.
Barbara, Isabella, remember your baptism and be thankful. And Isabella, the Holy Spirit worked within you that being born by water and the Spirit, you may become a true and faithful disciple of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And the people of God say, amen. Congratulations. Big day. Congratulations, big brother. Derek, Barbie, congratulations. We have a special way of doing it for twins. They both have to touch the water, and then they'll take turns. You can stand up and lay hands on it. This is Hunter. Okay, he's got his card. Okay, wow. I'm going to challenge this old man's ability to read here. There he is. Okay. Yeah. Hunter Reese, remember your baptism and be thankful. Hunter, the Holy Spirit working within you, being born by water and the Spirit. May you grow up to become a true and faithful disciple of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And the people of God said, amen. Amen. Congratulations. Devin Sky, remember your baptism and be thankful. The Holy Spirit work within you that being born by water and the Spirit, you may become a true and faithful disciple of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, Devin. And the people of God said, amen. Congratulations. Is that the full prayer? They've been through a course of study, they've been welcomed into the family of God, also known as the body of Christ. Would you rise and give our thanks to God for these young disciples? There is no such thing as a clock on Easter Sunday, right? Right? You understand that? Now, I've said this before, if you've got a roast that is going to burn and you do not want a burnt offering for Easter, we will understand if you need to head out. But we're not done here yet. And I would invite you to greet each other, pass the peace, and you might want to swing down here and hug on these families and these confirmants and these newly baptized brothers and sisters in Christ. So, greet one another in the name and the Spirit of our Lord. Gratitude.
The epistle lesson for this morning is taken from the third chapter of Paul's letter to the church at Colossae, Colossians 3, verses 1 through 4. There's rich content in this passage, so open your hearts to the word of the Lord. Paul writes, "So if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And for this next passage, I'm going to ask you to come to your feet for the sacred nature of this gospel, core story of our faith. Hear the word of the Lord according to John chapter 20, verses 1 through 18. "Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. She ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, 'They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him.' And Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. And the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head, the other at the feet. They said to her, 'Woman, why are you weeping?' She said to them, 'They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him.' When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, 'Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?' Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, 'Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away.' Jesus said to her, 'Mary.' She turned and said to him in Hebrew, 'Rabboni,' which means teacher. Jesus said to her, 'Do not hold on to me, because I've not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.' Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, 'I have seen the Lord.' And she told them that he had said these things to her." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Holy God, on this high and holy day, we pray that you will guide the spirit and the content of the words that utter from your servant's mouth, to the end that you may be glorified. So may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I will try to be brief. This is where my wife laughs. But I really will. But I'll try to be very pointed, because this is an important sermon to give to a family and youngsters that have been baptized and confirmed. You cannot top the
the fact of rising on Easter morning and understanding that God brought Jesus back to life, that death was defeated and that there was an empty tomb. In the scriptures we just read, we heard two traditions. We heard a tradition of the empty tomb that was merged beautifully with the tradition of the resurrection appearance. And both of them play into our understanding of the Christian faith. But the title of today's sermon, let's see if it made it in there. Who are you looking for has been changed to the heart of Easter. So the title of this message is The Heart of Easter. And one of the things that you know already is the heart of Easter is that Jesus was raised from the dead. And I'm going to share a couple of things to you about how important that is in the Gospel of John. How important that is. A couple of days ago, we were reading from the Gospel of John on Good Friday, and we heard Pilate questioning Jesus and asking Jesus when he was before him, before he was crucified, asking him some very pointed questions. And one of them was, "Are you the King of the Jews?" And Jesus answered, "You ask this on your own, or did others tell you about it?" Pilate replied, "I'm not a Jew. Your own nation, your priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" And Jesus says, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I'm a king. For this was I born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Pilate asked him, "What is truth?" Well, in the Gospel of John, right at the outset, we understand about truth. The people of faith look at the first chapter of John, the prologue, and it talks about truth right at the outset. It echoes the creation story. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. Well, what is truth? What is ultimate truth? It's what you see and are and breathe and feel and live into and live out of. And the Gospel of John indicates that Jesus Christ, the Word, is the foundation of truth. And that everything that is founded upon Jesus Christ by the act of God. So what is truth? Truth is standing right in front of Pilate. Truth is Jesus Christ. Beyond what any of us have imagined. So what we're going to talk about today is identity. Who is Jesus? Who is Jesus? And the identity starts with, he's the Word made flesh. He is God who walked with us. But he is also the man that came from heaven. In the story of, and we're staying within the thought frame and the thought world of the Gospel of John. But in this story, if you remember your geometry, there's a shape called a parabola. And the parabola kind of comes down and then curves. And it comes up. The shape of the Gospel of John is Jesus coming to be with us in the flesh. It's God coming to be with us in the flesh, in the person and the presence and the power of Jesus. And that part where Jesus is with us is the incarnation. That's when God is visible to us, and in the historic reality of the disciples, he was with them teaching and preaching and healing and praying. And then he dies, and the shape is that he is also the one who will return to God. And the return to God is important because Jesus says, "I will draw all people unto myself." And so we are to be followers in the same trajectory that Jesus has. From here, something happens in God's world that creates a new path for all humankind. We're going to talk about that. Identity. All right. There are a lot of Jesuses out there. And we're going to look at the identity of the Jesus of this gospel story, the Jesus of Easter. There is the peripheral Jesus, also known as Jesus of the sidelong glance. That's Jesus that's kind of in the corner of life, right? And then there's the background Jesus.
hanging around behind the scene in the corners of the mind. Then there's the out-of-focus Jesus, blurred by grief or by tears or by suffering or by affluence. Not in focus Jesus. Then there's the religious figure Jesus, and there's all kinds of religious figures Jesus. Then there's the social gospel Jesus, who lives on in the ministry to the poor and the needy and the oppressed, the belief in the works of mercy and social justice, honors the ministry and the memory of Jesus, and in a sense carries on the work of Jesus, but it's kind of just the social gospel Jesus. And then there's the personal Jesus. Jesus is mine, the personal friend, kind of a buddy, sometimes a pal. And then there's Aunt Ada's Jesus. Now, I'm naming all kinds of them, and some of them are Jesuses that you're familiar with. Aunt Ada's Jesus is the Jesus that you see in some relative, a grandmother, an uncle, a father, a cousin, a brother, a sister, that is an amazing faith. It's an amazing faith, but it's Aunt Ada's Jesus, and you believe in Aunt Ada's Jesus. It's a vicarious relationship because Aunt Ada, or whoever, fill in the blank, has this amazing faith. And then there's the boxed up in the package that I like, Jesus. You know, the tame Jesus, the one that just only doesn't step outside of the bounds that I'm comfortable with. He agrees with me politically, Jesus. And then there's safe at a distance, Jesus. Safe at a distance, Jesus, is also known as mind your own business, Jesus, because we don't want you to mess with my life. The word understand means lets me do what I want, Jesus. Is that the Jesus of the Gospel of John? Are any of those? They might have elements of the Jesus of the Gospel of John, but they're not the full story. We've got to understand something about the heart of Easter by looking at what we understand as heart in the 21st century and by looking at what the Bible means by heart. Listen closely. This is from a writer that lived more than 1,000 years ago. A guy didn't even know his name. He called him Pseudo-Macarius. When John Wesley read Pseudo-Macarius, his heart leapt with joy because Pseudo-Macarius talked about the spirituality of the heart and gets to the heart of what Jesus is about in the gospel story of Easter. It goes like this. The heart designates the human person as a whole. This is the biblical understanding of the heart. The human person as a whole. It is the ground or core of our being, the inner self, what in Zen Buddhism is termed the center of the lotus. It is at the same time the place where we come face to face with God and where the grace of the Spirit is active. And this is deep stuff. Once the heart is understood in this comprehensive way, it is surprising how many scriptural texts require sharper significance. When, for instance, it is said, the heart is deep, a key text in millions of Orthodox spirituality, the meaning is that the human person is, the human person as a whole is a profound mystery. The human person as a whole, a profound mystery, the divine appeal. My child, give me your heart, affirms that we are to entrust to God our entire being. They talk about the prayer of the heart, the Eastern mystics, and they have in mind the prayer of the total person, spirit, and body. Now listen to this illustration because it's filled with images. The heart itself, Macarius writes, is but a small vessel, yet dragons are there. There are also lions, and there are poisonous beasts and all the treasures of evil. There are also rough and uneven roads where there are precipices, but there too is God, the angels, the life and the kingdom, the light and the apostles, the heavenly cities and the treasures of grace. All things are there. There are infinite depths to the human heart. It is a symbol of much more than a beating organ, existing as it does in a whole series of interconnected levels. The heart is a central and controlling element in our physical structure. We understand that. We have a heart attack, we die. Or we could die. The heart directs and governs all other organs. This is an early biblical. When the heart ceases to function, bodily death ensues. Two, the heart is likewise the place in which the intellect is situated. And that's different. That's different from the Bible. Where the intellect is situated. For there in the heart and mind abides as well all the thoughts of the soul and its hopes. See how we're expanding the concept of heart, how we're understanding it in a new way through the Bible's eyes. In Macarius' scheme, there is no dichotomy between head and heart. We think with our hearts. Three, the heart also includes what we today designate as the unconscious. That part of us that sometimes we encounter in dreams. That part of us which is very real, but we're not aware of it at all times. Number four, the heart is the moral center, the point where grace and sin are experienced. There is found the office of justice and of injustice. There is death and there is life. The heart is in this way also the point of self-transcendence, where the encounter, where we encounter God. This is the place of transcendence where we encounter God, the palace of Christ, where he sets up his kingdom. Did you hear that? Our heart is the palace of Christ, where Christ sets up his kingdom. Through the heart, then, the divine grace permeates our entire personhood, not only transforming the soul, but penetrating also through all parts of the body. It is the symbol of our personal unity, the center where the physical and the non-material, the created and the uncreated converge. It is the point of meeting between body and soul, between the conscious and the unconscious, between human freedom and divine grace. Wow. Mary Magdalene couldn't see who Jesus was. She was looking in the empty tomb. She hadn't gotten to the point that it was good news. She was still at the point that it was tragic and horrible news, that they had further desecrated the body of her Lord and Savior by stealing it and taking it out and doing terrible things, maybe dragging it, maybe dismembering it. She was sure that in the same vein as the crucifixion, more bad stuff had happened. And that's where she was. And she turned around and she saw. One of the reasons she didn't see clearly, what do you think? Her eyes were filled with tears. She was grieving. Her eyes were filled with tears. She turned around and she saw Jesus. And Jesus said, "Why are you weeping?" In the grand King James Version, it says, "Woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou?" And presuming him to be the gardener, she says, "They've taken my master away. We do not know where they've laid him. Would you tell me so that I can go and get him?" Now, was she going to be able to handle the body of Jesus? Was she thinking in her right mind? I mean, that's a heavy load for a single lady to handle. And she says, you know, who, we don't know who would take. Well, in a sense, and I said this at the early service this morning, Jesus standing before him is the one who took the body. He walked and he was outside the grave at this point. He's the one that took the body and he's standing there. And he says her name, Mary. And she recognizes his name when he speaks it, because Jesus has said, "I'm the shepherd. And my sheep recognize my voice." And she immediately knew who it was. And she responded in a very loving form of the word teacher. It's like this word would mean beloved, wonderful, saving teacher, redeeming teacher. And she just went to hang on to him. And then comes that little section where we think, well, now why would he say that to her? She's really distraught. He says, you know, don't touch me. What we really have happening there is Jesus is in movement. Jesus is in movement. The resurrection is not the point of the story. We stop at the resurrection and think that's the point of the story. But Jesus takes us beyond that. And what he's saying to Mary is, I've got to keep moving. I am accomplishing in this hour what I came to do for God's holy purposes. And he reveals that to us when he says to her, the core of this whole passage. And it is, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. And he says, go and tell my brothers,
go and tell my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. The two angels that Mary saw inside, one at the head and one at the foot of where Jesus' body had been, didn't say, he is risen. He's outside. He's standing behind you. And they said simply, why are you weeping? There's a moment of high rejoicing that's happening here. And so Jesus, when she recognized him, turns her grief into joy. And he said he was going to do that. Your weeping is going to be turned to joy. He said he was going to do that reversal. You're going to have, you know, this worst possible scenario, which is driving your emotion, and which you assumed had happened, because we always expect the worst has happened, is not the case. Jesus has walked away from death through the power of God and is standing behind her and says, this is the message. Yes, the resurrection appearance is important, but it's not the point. The point of Easter is what Jesus says, I am going to my Father and to your Father, to my God and your God. And he says, go and tell this to my brothers. He uses a form of the Greek word adelphoi, which means my community. Go and tell my community that I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. And we go back to the prologue, we find out what's going on here. Something new is happening. It says in the prologue something that my father inscribed in a Bible he gave to me when I was too young to understand it. He inscribed this in the Bible. Dad wrote, but to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of a human man and woman, but of God. He gave power to become children of God. Something new is happening. Something new is happening when Jesus is ascended. Confirmants, listen up. When Jesus is ascended and returns, the man from heaven has spent time in the earth doing the work of God in order to draw all human beings unto himself. When Jesus has ascended, that the work of God's salvation is completed and it is confirmed by Jesus' ascent. Do you hear the word confirmed? Confirmed by Jesus' ascent. So the resurrection, the heart of the resurrection, is the ascended Lord that reigns. And what Jesus had promised to the disciples in the closed room is, I'm not going to orphan you. I'm going to send you a spirit. I'm going to send you the paraclete, the comforter. I'm going to send you my presence, my power, my life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I'm going to send you that. And that couldn't be accomplished until he was back with the Father and enthroned by the Father and putting all things under Jesus. All things under Jesus. Now, do you believe that deeply? Do you believe that deeply? Because if you believe it lightly, you're not there yet. If you believe it deeply, you know that your being depends on Jesus Christ. Your life depends on Jesus Christ. And that Jesus has given the power of a new way of being. That's why it's called a new creation. The power of a new way of being in the world. The theologians call it ontology. The ontological reality has changed. Something new is available. God wasn't available to everybody by the Holy Spirit until Jesus returned to heaven and began to reign. And the Holy Spirit was then released to the church. And so God now communicates directly to people. When we say, he lives, he lives. How do we know he lives? He lives within my heart. Right? So the heart of the resurrection is the work that was accomplished as Jesus was ascended and now reigns in glory and has made available to us the very same relationship with God, the very same intimate, loving relationship with God that Jesus had. That's why Jesus said, I'm going to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God, because the very same spirit of power and healing and love and light, the uncreated, indestructible force of life that I give to you, is the same power that God displayed to you through me. That's a new relationship. That's the heart. That's the heart of Easter. It's not just that Jesus walked out of the grave. That's important. It is. But it's that God has fulfilled God's promises that all flesh would see the glory of God. And the glory of God is going to be displayed in us, who Jesus has already named as the light of the world. So if Jesus is in our hearts, there is a part of us that can never die. A part of us that death has no power over. And we live out of a new
reality, the reality of the risen Christ, the reality of the resurrection, where the uncreated life of God has begun to affect and change and move in our lives to help restore in us the very image of God. And as we love and forgive and love and see in every other mortal being one for whom Christ died, we become the body of Christ. We are the body of Christ. We are living into the name that we carry, which is Christian. Christian means little Christs. So that it's Christ that needs to be enthroned in our hearts. Nothing else. Amen. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
I told you I'd tell you about your new identity.
somebody could listen in and remember your new identity. It's what Jesus calls you directly in your heart. Beloved disciple. Beloved disciple. Amen. I mean, the love of God, the peace of Christ, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you and remain in you forever. Amen. Shall we sing it?
Praise his name, number 327.
Crown with crowns. And if you need to rededicate or make that commitment to him, his love, the altars are always open.
Amen.